We are hitting our marks here time-wise, and so now we're into one of the great films, Heartbeat, which I remember when this came out in 1980, probably a lot of us do, probably none of us would have ever seen Subterraneans on the screen, but this came out at least in some of our lifetimes, and I certainly remember. And I made, for decades, I've made the mistake of, you know, being really into the authenticity of the beats and Jack's work and everything. And so anything that in any way, you know, wasn't exactly like my mind of it, or, you know, the people in the beat generation poo-pooed it or something, I'm like, okay, I'll poo-poo it. And so I, you know, had sort of a mixture to negative review of Heartbeat. Watched it again now a couple of times in the last few years, and this is a great film. The main thing I want to say is they wrote it as a romantic comedy, and there is no other example in, I think, film or any other adaptation of the Beats where it's put on a comedic bent. And as you may know, Jack and Neil were huge W.C. Fields fans, and they loved comedy. And so romantic comedies were a staple of Hollywood in the years that Jack was doing his thing, the 40s, 50s, you know, like Cary Grant and Audrey Hepburn and Kate Hepburn too. You know, Philadelphia Story, Arsenic and Old Lace, His Girl Friday, Bringing Up Baby. They were all, it was a whole genre of romantic comedies. And so when this guy, John Birnam, interpreted it, and rewrote the screenplay, like, it's written as a comedy. And if you, I highly recommend everybody here find this and watch it again. And because I think, like, a lot of people were, you know, bitching about it back when it came out, because for one thing, I guess there hadn't been a real interpretation for 20 years, since 1960. This thing comes out and, you know, it's not, I don't know, whatever reasons people bitched about it. But watch for all, there are all of these comedic scenes that are written into it. So once you kind of twig that this is like, and which were the popular movies of the time. And it's a romantic movie in the sense that it's a love story between, you know, Carolyn and Neil and Jack and the kind of menage a trois type of thing. But the art direction, the location shooting, the casting, the costuming, the music, Jack Nietzsche did the score for it, it's fantastic. So there's all these elements of it that this was a really, really good movie that has really been sort of, you know, shunned aside a bit in the beat world, but it makes it to my, I mean, it works in my mind. And I learned this lesson to stop bitching about this stuff, you know? That, like, you know, there was three adaptations, climax of the show, On the Road, Kill Your Darlings, and Big Sur. And, you know, people tend to, you know, because we all love this stuff, and we've all got the movies in our head, and we all, you know, don't want anybody to mess with the sacred text and these sacred people. But this is just a really fun interpretation. So I highly recommend re-watching this. And by the way, Nick Nolte as Neil, was really into Cassidy and Kerouac, and had just in the prior movie, just before this one, Who'll Stop the Rain, which is written by Robert Stone, a colleague of Kesey's. The character that Robert Stone wrote was based on Neil Cassidy. So you've got Nick Nolte is literally playing Cassidy in two consecutive movies. And so this first one, the first clip is, has got, it's also got Jack Kerouac as a cameo. I'll just read you her. She wrote about it in Train Song. And she said, in September, I was offered the job as an extra in Heartbeat, a movie about my father's menage a trois with the Cassidys. The Acropolis Cafe was just the place for a Beat Generation coffee house scene. A Greek restaurant in downtown LA, unchanged since the 30s. My job was to sit at a table where two guys were playing chess, to follow their moves like a cat, to look mildly bored, and to puff like mad on camels to produce a thick, smoke-filled atmosphere. So she's in this scene, now, which is about 4 minutes or something in the movie, and so she's not, you're gonna see a lot of her, but she'll be right over here in the corner, and here's just a little snippet of Jack, Neil, and Carol.
I love Rachel Jack.
Well, there's still a discernible trace of Wolfian influence in the more picaresque sections. Freshen your cocktail?
Yes, please, Jack.
Really as good a writer as he acts like he is?
Oh, it's not an act. He's really a good writer.
Cool, eh? Okay, now the other clip I want to show from this real quick, just another minute, is the writing in the room. And I try to, throughout these, chosen clips that I'm pulling from these movies to kind of come up with writer clips. There's a good scene involving the act of writing. And so we're going to play that, and there'll be a moment in this where a shot of John Hurd with the scroll all strewn around the room, and this image has circulated around the internet as though it's actual Jack writing on the roads, which is kind of a funny little blend of, you know, and how things get screwy in internet land. But you'll see where that image comes from that you've probably seen captioned as Jack Kerouac writing on the road.
What are you going to do with that, T.P. the Cat?
Nope. I'm going to finish typing my book through fooling around. I'm going to play this thing like Charlie Park.
Bennies.
Forget it, I need them.
It's a big hurry all of a sudden.
No hurry, same hurry. You know, riches, fame, overnight success, house in the hills, little lady, picket fence, couple of kids, a station wagon.
Like something up better than a flop house.
Yeah, a little bit better.
You sucker, Jack.
Sucker? Huh? Sucker for what, Neil?
Just I found this. Jack Nietzsche does all the music, and it's absolutely spectacular. And Roger Ebert, in his 1980 review, said this movie is a triumph of art direction. I completely agree. The locations, the costuming, lighting, moods, music, and whole tone of the performances are designed to lower a kind of nostalgic drop cloth over the whole story. Which I think is, you know, again, this is pretty great filmmaking, and we should all be grateful that it happened. And by the way, all of these things, all of the Kerouac movies were done on shoestring budgets, and they got the people in them. Three major movie stars right there you just saw, worked for, you know, kind of great pay cuts because they wanted to do a Kerouac movie. This, the whole budget for this entire movie was $3 million. So that's the same case Walter Salles told me about, like, that everybody involved in On the Road was there because it was On the Road and Jack Kerouac and their love for him. So you'll see a number of movies tonight that have low budget, but all of these superstars do it because of a love for Jack. Okay, so now we're on to, give me the next title
card. Hey, Brian?
Yes?
I was gonna say, you probably know, in the Down and Out in Beverly Hills, Nick Nolte has a dog.
Called Kerouac.
Yeah.
I think that's actually even the very first word spoken in the movie.
Yeah.
The credit, and you hear Nick Nolte going, Kerouac!
Yes.
Kerouac!
That's funny.
Yeah, that's and a good one, you're right.
Around the time of the commemorative, we had some contact with Nick Nolte, and he was going to come and do a dramatic reading. Yeah, it was going to be crazy. Alan had brokered it, and I think Grossman was involved through Alan to Nick Nolte, and then it kind of fell apart for a couple of reasons, not like money or financing or anything, it was just like schedules and stuff like that. But he was, around that time, 87, 88, he was heavy into Kerouac.
He really was. He was really into it. And the whole Cassidy family was on set for the whole filming of that thing. And John and he kind of hit it off. And Nolte invited him out to his ranch and stuff. But John didn't make it out there. But yeah, he, you know, he was really into it. And, you know, God bless it. And that's how a lot of this stuff has come into being, is because so many people are willing to work for next to nothing to make an homage to Kerouac. So we're not barking up the wrong tree here. Okay, so then by 1990, so it's 10 years after that, Quantum Leap does an episode set in Big Sur in 1958. And watching all of these things, I think this is one of the best portrayals of Kerouac. And it's just one scene. I'm going to show you the whole scene in its entirety. It's only 2 minutes long. And I think this guy does a great job. Whoever the scriptwriter was for this show wrote a great script for this little 2 minutes. And, you know, all of us in this room are pretty particular about, you know, somebody putting words into Jack's mouth that weren't his. And, you know, and the TV show did a pretty darn good job. And so you think about the trend, you know, the process or the progression from 1960, this abysmal Subterraneans, to a pretty cool 1980 Heartbeat, to here's how he comes out, you know, here's how he, how Hollywood is portraying him in 1990.
No. No, I've got to see. I've got to do.
I've got to move. I've got to groove. Away from the rumbling hooves of suffocating mediocrity. That's what you were thinking, wasn't it?
Oh my God. You're Jack Kerouac.
It's Jack Kerouac. I was talking to a friend the other day about this very subject. He was illuminating like a thunderstorm at midnight. And when I overheard your dilemma on my quest for a cup of coffee, I couldn't help but be reminded of it and other things. On the wheel of life, we all go around. We are many people at many times. We all go through phases of motion, of ocean, of the notion of living on the edge of life or of a continent. But the road is not made of asphalt, but of the people we meet. And each of us is on a different journey, and that's okay. So sometimes it's okay to get off the road we ride on wheels and just stay. Something will come of it. Because that's a world worth writing about too.
Say, my man, how about that? A cup of coffee.
Well, I'll come back later. When it's hot.
So that's pretty cool, right? I thought. And the jazz score, they worked the jazz in there. And I love that line, you know, the road is not made of asphalt, but of the people we meet. That's out of Jack's school. And this is on, I think I got this from, somebody just snagged this clip. And it's a Facebook video. And reading the comments, like about a half a dozen different people commented, I went and read On the Road after seeing this clip or this episode. So that's, you know, part of the good thing about all of this, that like all of these different interpretations, you know, make the popcorn kernel go off for different people. And so, you know, God bless them, keep making them. Because that's how people find this, and we all had our own weird way, and for a bunch of people, they found Kerouac because of Quantum Leap. So, Naked Lunch. This was kind of like On the Road. This was not a literal adaptation of the book by any stretch. It's more of a story of Burroughs' life when he was writing Naked Lunch. What do I want to say? Oh, yeah. So it's written and directed by David Cronenberg, which I was stunned to learn has never even been nominated for a single Oscar. All the movies, I would have got that wrong on a quiz. But this movie won. They have Canadian Oscars called Genies. And this won Best Picture, Best Director, and Best Cinematography. At least the Canadians recognized it. God bless them. So it was, this thing was entirely filmed in Toronto, I just like the... It's a good little writing scene. So I guess just hit it, let it go. You could. So it's obviously Jack and Alan and Burroughs in Tangier when he's writing... when Burroughs is writing Naked Lunch.
Always jest. We thought it was important for us to help you get your book together.
Yeah, I've sent sections of it to my publisher and they're interested. All you gotta do is finish it, man.
You've already done the hard part.
My book?
Yeah, the one you've been calling Naked Lunch.
Put that Bradley the buyer routine. Did you find it all?
Yeah, and spare on the sofa right next to the Sans Rumpus room. It's all right there.
I'm telling you, boys, I never saw those pages before. I truly do suspect some sort of colossal con.
Oh, someone's planted these pages in your room, right?
Somebody sent all those letters to me and signed them with your name, right?
A well-orchestrated cabal could easily manage all of these simple things, children. When will you learn?
Well, they've done you a favor, Bill, because this stuff's going to get published under your name, and you'll have a career.
Yeah, you'll probably get into print before we will. For God's sake, Bill, play ball with this conspiracy.
You're patronizing me, boys. But I don't mind, because you're so sweet to me, too.
Marvelous nurse. So we start from New Orleans past iridescent lakes and orange gas flares and swamps and garbage heaps. Alligators crawling around in broken bottles and tin cans. Neon arabesques of motels. Maroon pimps scream obscenities at passing cars from islands of rubbish. New Orleans is a dead museum.
So nice. Sound familiar, Bill?
First time I ever heard it. Read on.
Okay, so call up. All right, so anyway, that's kind of cool. I mean, that's one more portrayal of Jack on the big screen by a major director. Okay, so we're on to there's about like five movies that I think are really the key Jack films, which would be Pull My Daisy, Heartbeat, this one, Big Sur, and I don't know, something else I'm forgetting. But the last time I committed suicide, have many people here seen the last time I committed suicide? Nah, kind of a handful. I think it's one of the best adaptations. Carolyn Cassidy said she thought it was the best adaptation she saw. She thought Thomas Jane was the closest thing to Kerouac that she saw on screen. So it's got those two imprimaturs. What else I want to say? And when George Walker said this, he thought this was the closest to Kerouac that to Cassidy that he ever saw on screen, and George knew Neil really well. And Keanu Reeves is in this, and him signing on is why the movie got financed. So God bless him for that. And also, like, On the Road, as I said, is not like a linear adaptation of the novel. It sort of jumps around and adds stuff in that was also part of Kerouac's life. So this is the earliest beat writing ever turned into a film. This was written in the famous letter to Jack, the surviving part of the famous letter of Jack to Jack, written in December 1950, about Christmas 1946. Neil's letter to Jack, and of course he'd never met Jack or Alan by this time. So the screenwriter took the liberty to sort of write a Kerouac-like character into it and an Alan-like character into it, even though this was before Cassidy had ever met either of them, but it kind of makes for great cinema. Yeah, I think that's the main stuff. Okay, so, and then this first clip we're gonna show is them going on the road, and I'm just showing this because it's just terrific on the road energy, and which is what we love about this stuff. And the last shot you're gonna see in this, Stephen Holden, reviewing it for the New York Times, described it as, this movie has the nostalgic tug of a Saturday Evening Post cover. And you're gonna see, I think, what he was thinking of when he wrote that line. But this is just some beautiful cinematography by, this is the one by Charles Bukowski, I'm pretty positive. Yeah, no relation to the poet, but great cinematographer, obviously. Go ahead, just hit it.
By the time I swore off such soul-thrilling pleasures, nearly a decade later, I'd had illegally in my possession about 500 cars, whether taken just for the moment to be returned to their owner later, or whether taken for the purpose of so altering its appearance as to keep it for several weeks. Wow, man, that was all one sentence.
It's not what we needed! Come on, man!
Oh, my God!
Astronomy or physics or geology?
They teach you that the only thing that's keeping us from flying off into nowhere is spinning.
Woo! Neil!
Time is now.
great shot. And so I'm going to show one other clip from it, which is all, which has got a great portrayal of both Jack and Neil, and Jack, and including Jack using Neil to try to get girls. And something to note in this, it's going to be handheld cinematography that really kind of puts you in the back alley with the two of them, and watch how the actors kind of improvise around this, and how the camera works with the actors. It's just a good moment of filmmaking.
I just wanted to. Damn, it's cold. Anyway, I just wanted to thank you for the number. And I don't know, buy another.
Here, I got somewhere to be, man. I told you before.
Sure, right. And I would never want to. How far do you think that was? Feels like a goddamn. Man, I gotta get in shape like you, Neil.
Strong, lean.
You know, that's how you pick up.
Here, let's do this fast, shall we? Why don't you tell me precisely what it is that you need and I'll tell you no, all right?
Okay. She said she couldn't come down right now. But call her in half an hour.
Great. To call her in half an hour and have a great time.
Well, she sort of said that. See, she said. She asked for you to call her.
Excuse me?
She said she would love to hear the sound of your voice. And your mother's
not even mad at you until now, Zay.
My head? Now it's getting nowhere. I feel like icy Christmas.
I need help. And I can't help you, Harry. Okay? Okay, man? I can't help you. Please.
Just a call. A conversation.
Harry.
Again, this was another one of this had a $4 million budget, and they got Aidan Brody, Keanu Reeves, Thomas Jane, Claire Forlani, and Gretchen Mol. I mean, major, major stars, all doing it for a minuscule budget. So anyway, I highly recommend this. I think this is one of the best cinematic adaptations of Jack, and it's Neil Letter, but a Jack work in the beat genre. Okay, the next movie that came along was absolutely abysmal, and we're not going to touch it. It was called Beat, with Kiefer Sutherland, Courtney Love, Ron Livingston, and Norman Reedus as Lucian. And it's about basically Joan and Joan and Burroughs in Kiefer Sutherland playing Burroughs in Mexico, and it's just horrible. Another one of these, one of those, and it makes you wonder. And there's not really any Jack in it, and I think he got cut out of it. And I heard, I don't know if it's 100% true, but I heard that like John Sampas saw the thing, and it was like, this is just a disaster, and kind of pulled the rights to use Jack's image in it. And so he was in an early cut of it, and then was not in the final release, because it's just so bad. And you're watching this and wondering, like, do people who make movies like this, does Kiefer know when you're in the middle of this, that this thing is just an absolute disaster and is going nowhere? I just wonder about how that works for people in the middle of things. Oh, okay, this is cool. This is another sizzle reel. The Starving Hysterical Naked. My never-ending search of this stuff. This is another movie that never got made that had a sizzle reel. The director made this little 10-minute excerpt and posted it to YouTube in 2012, and it has 400 views in 10 years. So nobody has discovered this thing. It's called Starving Hysterical Naked, And it was supposed to be, it's a Kerouac movie, supposed to be about Jack and kind of the Columbia years and everything. And it's got Billy Zane playing Jack. I bet you didn't expect you were going to see one of the stars of Titanic portraying Kerouac. And as you're going to see, he does a great job. And so this is just the little parts of it that have got this major A-list Hollywood movie star. It may be the most physically accurate portrayal of Kerouac on film. In a movie that never ended up getting made, and only 400 people in the world have ever clicked on to see this thing. So here's a sizzle reel of a movie that didn't get made, but with an A-list movie star playing Jack Kerouac.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening, and welcome to The Hungry Eye. Tonight, The Hungry Eye is proud to present a very talented young writer whose first novel is set to come out this September on Viking Press. Put your hands together for Nick Constantine.
Time in my youth, which was not so long ago, before I developed the dissolute habits of my current ways, when I, fresh-faced and cocksure confident, came to the city in search of adventure. And I found it too, though not what I expected. Not in those stale college classrooms where professors blah-blah about the collective wisdom of the ages with brain-numbing tedium, nor in the inviting smiles of cashmere-sweated co-eds, all goodness and sweetness, who seemed to promise adventure. Dangle adventure, ooze adventure, but eventually delivered up everything except adventure. I found it instead in the harsh gutters, the cold water flats, the glittering glories of 24-hour neon Manhattan, in the chorus of a million New York voices riffing with bebop of auto horns and jackhammers and cop sirens, in steamy August afternoons, where slick-skinned children frolic in fire hydrant geysers, in old lonely winter nights, soft arms of a beautiful woman.
Somebody's calling you.